Now, today we're taking up the subject of theology and sociology, building on the last contribution from Joel Robbins on theology and anthropology, and Brad Gregory before that on theology and history. Before I do introduce John, I just would like to remind you of the other remaining two in this series for this year. I put out a little leaflet here and there, you might get a glance at that, to say that Irene Tracy, Professor of Anesthetic Science from Oxford, will be here in March to talk on theology and neuroscience. And then Chris McCrudden, who is, of course, Professor of Human Rights Law here at Queen's, will be talking in April on theology and law. And we're now beginning to plan what we might be doing to continue the series next academic year. So it's a great pleasure to welcome our own Professor John Brewer to address this topic today. John spent many years here at Queen's before he went on to become 6th century professor of sociology at the University of Aberdeen, where he also acted as head of department for a period of time there, as he had done here before he left, and then returned to the professorship of post-conflict studies here at Queen's about 4 years ago in 2013. Now, John has worked in a very fertile set of areas, initially actually working quite a bit on sociology and its history, going back into the Scottish Enlightenment, and I think has never really forgotten that intellectual heritage that he worked on, but has worked on many related themes, policing, both here and in South Africa, before moving more and more centrally to work on themes of post-conflict, community reconciliation, and the like. John is the author of 13 books, all of them by highly prestigious presses, many with the Clarendon Press from Oxford University Press. He's written on religion, civil society and peace in Northern Ireland, peace processes inside the RUC, and many, many others. And it is not at all surprising that he has been elected to Fellowship of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, membership of the Royal Irish Academy, and is now a past president of the British Sociological Association. He has been a visiting fellow at Yale, St John's College, Oxford, Corpus Christi, Cambridge, and indeed the Australian National University. So it is a great pleasure to have John, one of our own, speaking to us, and indeed to be in the august company of the other distinguished people we've had participating in this series. John, we look forward to what you have to tell us about theology and sociology.
Thank you very much, David. Well, it's a great pleasure and an honour to be here, and I'm grateful to David for the invitation. The lecture is going to be partly autobiographical. I am in the story, and I have lived through and indeed contributed to the transition in the relationship between theology and sociology that I will be talking about. Intellectual lives are not experienced linearly. They're shaped by the key spaces of selfhood, as I once described them. Now, these spaces of selfhood leave an enduring legacy that mediate the future cultural and disciplinary spaces and indeed the physical places which constitute an academic life. And I'm going to be talking a little bit about my academic life. So this lecture then is not just about the disciplinary spaces of theology and sociology and their meeting place in the two sub-disciplines of the sociology of religion and religious studies. It's a lecture also about my attempts to re-enchant sociology with some of the concerns of theology. And it is also about the cultural and physical space of Belfast during the Troubles, and indeed of Queen's University as a particular cultural space in the 1980s, which indeed impacted on some of the broader disciplinary concerns that I will be talking about. But I first want to talk about another space, As David alluded, I spent 9 happy years in the granite city of Aberdeen. And significantly, it was in the cultural and physical spaces of Aberdeen that my work on the sociology of peace processes came to the fullest expression. I moved on intellectually from a concern with the sociological dynamics of conflict, which I spent all my professional life in Durban, Norwich, and Belfast studying. In Aberdeen, my interests consolidated around studying peace and the array of sociological concepts that re-enchant the discipline, and in which I believe helped to reconnect it with theology. Now, I will not speculate here on why I had to leave Queens as a cultural space for my intellectual interests in to shift towards peace. But I do want to say something more mundane about Aberdeen. Those of you who know Aberdeen know that it is a cultural and intellectual space that experiences a geographic isolation. As a physical place, its sociology department remains the furthest north of all in the UK, nearer to Bergen than to London. And as head, I used several seminar and lecture series to compensate for its deficiencies as a space. Now, one lecture series was on the discipline of sociology and what I called its strange others. Now, the Reverend Professor Robin Gill, then the Archbishop of Canterbury's ethics advisor and a leading religious studies scholar, gave a talk on theology and sociology. But when I came to publish the talks in a special issue of a journal, he could not commit to writing it, having had a brutal encounter with a sociologist of secularization at Aberdeen. And so I wrote the article instead. So what follows here, therefore, is very much an update on my 2007 article in the Journal of the History of Human Sciences on theology and sociology. Now, in what follows, I will make 10 propositions. This is many fewer than Martin Luther, but 9 more than you should make in a short lecture. So I will be brief in articulating them. Proposition 1. In the 20th century, sociology reduced the study of religion to the sociology of secularization. The sociology of religion weakened and marginalized itself by its obsession with secularization, to the point where it became the sociology of secularization, concerned principally with 2 aspects of religion. First, the decline in religious observance and identification, and secondly, the importance and emphasis on choice for those remaining believers when determining their preferred form of religiosity. So, in the sociology of secularization, religion is turned into a preference, not a duty, and institutional religion loses its monopoly. Proposition 2. The sociology of secularization was promulgated most trenchantly by sociologists from Queens, with a strong atheist belief at the height of the Troubles in the 1980s, when it seemed to these atheists that this space only confirmed that religious belief was a problem and a nuisance. Now, it's no coincidence that 2 of the UK's chief proponents of the sociology of religion, Roy Wallace and Steve Bruce, were at Queen's during the worst of the Troubles. Nor is it paradoxical that both also championed the view that the religious content of the conflict should be taken seriously when interpreting it. Not a paradox, because they reduced religion to a surrogate. So the elision of religion and ethnicity in Northern Ireland was thus not incompatible with claiming the irrelevance of religious belief in society. Indeed, it explained it. Proposition 3. Sociology did not take religion seriously. When religious practice survived as a lived experience, it was because it stood in for something else. It was really about power, politics, class, ethnicity, or whatever. Now, this might explain why Bruce has concerned himself solely in his academic career with conservative evangelicalism, and Wallace, before his death, solely with new religious movements, forms of religiosity that are more easily reducible to broader social processes. Now, this dismissal of religion contrasts markedly with sociology's treatment in the 19th century. In that space, religion was one of the principal social forces in understanding social life. No sociologist ignored religion in the 19th century. And this neglect differs with the beginning of the 20th century, when many of the leading sociologists in the United States and in Britain were children of the manse. And they took religion very seriously. Now, as sociology professionalized in the 20th century, religion was reduced to a derivative, something secondary, something reducible. And you may wish to look at my 2007 article for an account of the religious beliefs of early sociologists. It's little known, I suspect, that Christian sociologists helped to establish the discipline on both sides of the Atlantic, and that a journal of Christian sociology ran for 20 years in Britain. Proposition 4. In marginalizing religion, sociology also neglected a whole series of important issues in social life. These were marginalized because they were mistakenly thought to be rooted in faith, or thought to require religious belief, or thought that they could only be understood theologically. And these topics included topics like empathy, love, hope, mercy, anger, forgiveness, suffering, compromise, peace, and the like. Now, elsewhere, I have referred to these topics as constituting sociology's second cognitivist revolution. The first being the discovery of the topic of everyday life in the 1960s. Now, my point here is that the disciplinary space of sociology neglected these issues because they were thought to invoke religion. So these topics were like babies thrown out with the bathwater, thought to comprise the intellectual space of theology, not sociology. Proposition 5. The serious study of religion was re-engaged in sociology in the last two decades of the 20th century. But it was re-engaged by people from outside the subdisciplinary space of the sociology of religion, a space that still remains enclosed, insular, dare I say, incestuous. The serious study of religion has been revisited by three sets of outsiders. First, religious studies experts in the 1980s who discovered a rather naive enthusiasm for sociology. Secondly, by mainstream sociologists in the 1990s who saw the importance of religion in the public sphere. And thirdly, by sociologists of religion who have a personal faith. Now, with respect to the latter group, for example, sociologists of religion with personal faith, some of the best representatives of what we might call the new sociology of religion, which we can define as that subdisciplinary space that takes the public role of religion seriously, these have spaces of selfhood that include strong personal religious belief, such as Linda Woodhead and such as Gladys Ganiel, to name only two. The second group is also interesting as well. Sociological giants like Habermas, Calhoun, Beck, working from intellectual spaces outside of the sociology of religion. They have pioneered the re-engagement with religion in late modernity. And they've been able to re-engage religion precisely because they were not limited by the sociology of secularization. Indeed, they benefited from not being sociologists of religion, because they were now enabled to go beyond the limited range of concerns that the sociology of religion has. They were able to use a language beyond the language of this subdiscipline. They were able to envisage a potential for the study of religion that sociologists of secularization cannot. And for this reason, these figures are often quarrelsomely dismissed by sociologists of secularization. No respecters of reputation. Proposition 6. The re-enchantment of sociology is also provoked by the rise of global conflicts and peace processes. Global conflicts, peace processes, have brought attendant new risks, new vulnerabilities, new uncertainties. And this has led to the re-emergence of a whole range of issues in late modernity that have a close connection with theology. Forgiveness, empathy, compassion, compromise, love, hope, mercy, suffering, anger, all of which were once thought to be incompatible with secular sociology because they were thought, as I said, to invoke religion. And this is the second cognitivist revolution in sociology that I referred to earlier. It is a revolution of the new millennium. As global challenges caused by poverty, war, climate change, the growth of religious violence, increasing social injustice, these issues of the new millennium have provoked some sociologists from outside the sociology of secularization to engage with a new conceptual apparatus and a new vocabulary. Forgive me if I point to a deep irony here. I can't stop myself pointing out this irony. Late modernity has paradoxically undermined the sociology of secularization, which is why we have terms like post-secularity or de-secularization. Terms of the new sociology of religion. In now constructing the meaning of their own lives reflexively, free from the constraints of institutional religion, free from the constraints of tradition, from church. Some individuals, some groups, some communities have brought religion back into the public square. So sociologists of secularization, therefore, must now give witness both to the growth of secularization and to a growing public role for religion. Now, public religion sits uneasily with sociologists of secularization. But the idea of public religion returns us to the 19th century sociology pioneers who took religion seriously because of its central public role. But the return of public religion occurs at the same time as which there is a real decline in religious practice. The return of public religion does not imply a return by the majority to the pews. The paradox of public religion in late modernity is that the pews remain empty. It is no longer the number of devotees that endow religion with social significance, but the return of religion to the public square. Now, understanding this paradox proffers a significant challenge to the sociologists of secularization, which they have not yet resolved. Proposition 7. Religion is now truly an interdisciplinary space. An interdisciplinary space in which sociologists of secularization have largely made themselves irrelevant. So discussion of the new conceptual apparatus is by theologians, by sociologists from outside the sociology of secularization, and by anthropologists, as we saw in the last lecture in this series. But it's also contributed to by transitional justice scholars, by criminologists, by religious studies specialists, and other social scientists. There's fruitful engagement around an array of concepts. And these concepts represent a space in which there is a re-engagement. But sociologists of secularization, however, are often limited in their understanding of the complexity of concepts like forgiveness, hope, mercy, empathy. They're limited because of their dismissal of religion, their dismissal of theology, and their dismissal of faith. So in my experience, theologians have a better understanding of the operation of forgiveness in society and politics than do sociologists of secularization. My complaint to theologians is that they do not wrestle enough with applied theology, tending to avoid putting their ideas into practice in hard situations. Proposition 8. For all that I have said about sociology's re-enchantment, it is very restricted and constrained. Sociology studies war more than peace, conflict more than reconciliation. And I am ploughing almost a lone furrow in championing the sociology of peace processes. And all the attendant interest in the sociological conceptualization of compromise, or everyday life peace building, or the sociology of hope, the sociology of forgiveness, the sociology of mercy, and the sociology of anger, and the sociology of love, and so on. Sociologists' mistake comes, I think, in believing that a sacred eschatology is necessary for us to discuss forgiveness, hope, mercy, and the like. I believe this is plainly wrong, as 2 decades of my own work has tried to show. I believe that sociology's re-enchantment illuminates features of an empirical world which are otherwise hidden, and it offers significant conceptual insight into how to theorize this world. And I hope to demonstrate this in 2 books, if you'll forgive my plug, in 2 books that I've authored, which are coming out next year. One on the sociology of compromise, and another on the sociology of everyday life peace building. Proposition 9. Late modernity, as I said, has created new risks, new fears, new issues, new citizenship engagements, new demands. I believe that these new risks, fears, and vulnerabilities are conducive to religiosity. In late modernity, people still ask deeply religious questions. Who am I? What is the meaning of life? Does life have a meaning? Is this all there is to life? But they do not answer these questions by organized institutional religion. Now, I call these religious questions because organized atheism is not asking these questions. It tends only to ridicule and to dispute the answers within organized religion. But they are religious questions for another reason. Regardless of the decline of institutional religion, people have and want a moral compass. But they do not find this moral compass in organized religion. Now, I have discovered the truth of this search for moral compass in 6 years of research amongst victims of conflict in Northern Ireland, South Africa, and Sri Lanka, where I have undertaken nearly 200 interviews with victims. Now, I refer to this moral compass, and I'm a typical sociologist in using obfuscating language, I refer to this moral compass as the relational ethic of sociability. I would with that. What I mean is a commitment to get along. A commitment to get along for the sake of their children and their grandchildren. That their children and grandchildren must not go through what they went through. I see this moral compass in most first-generation victims in Northern Ireland, South Africa, and Sri Lanka. And it is remarkable that of all people, victims embody and practice this moral compass. Proposition 10. The sociology of secularization is having great difficulty in understanding why people are still asking religious questions but not going to church for the answers. The concept of secularization, which is the principal lens through which the sociology of secularization perceives religion, the concept does not capture what is going on when people find answers to these questions in many different forms of spiritual life. So the sociology of secularization does not know what status to accord religion in late modernity, other than to dismiss it. One could say that God is back, but not in the form sociologists of secularization, or theologians, recognize. If I'm going to paraphrase Star Trek, religion has life, but not as we knew it. I need to conclude. How? Well, I have 10 propositions but one point. As a critic once said of Alfred Schurz, one of the principal sociologists of the first cognitivist revolution in sociology, he was a one-point man. Well, that can be said of me here too. My point is that space, cultural, disciplinary, physical, space explains the tortured relationship between sociology and theology. But space also lies behind the re-enchantment of sociology, a re-enchantment that encourages a new, fruitful, interdisciplinary re-engagement with theology. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, John. We now await, in this year of Luther, the further 85. But if it is only one point, gosh, we've 94 to go through. But a very stimulating and challenging talk. I think I should also say that two of the virtues that John feels that sociology ignores need to be put into practice today. And those are the virtues of empathy and compassion. For this reason, John is actually suffering very badly from sciatic pain this afternoon. That's why he's going to have to stand during the rest of the proceedings. So I hope you'll extend that degree of empathy and compassion to you. And thanks for coming along under those strained circumstances.
It's called friendship.
Sociology of friendship. It's a great pleasure now to welcome, to give just a short response to John's lecture this afternoon, Gladys Ganyal. Gladys is a fellow in the George Mitchell Institute here for Global Peace, Security and Justice, and previously, before coming to this post, was an associate professor in Trinity College Dublin's Irish School of Ecumenics. Now, Gladys works in an interdisciplinary, can I say, space, John, between sociology, religious studies, and politics. Her main areas of research are in the Northern Ireland conflict, evangelicalism, Christianity in Ireland, the emerging church, and charismatic Christianity in Zimbabwe and South Africa. She is the author of a number of books and articles, including The Deconstructed Church and Evangelicalism and Conflict in Northern Ireland, and has a forthcoming book, I think, from Oxford University Press, Transforming Post-Conflict Ireland. So Gladys, we look forward to the remarks that you'd like to make. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir. I'll quickly say that book has been published and get that out of the way.
All right.
First of all, I want to thank John for providing us with such rich food for thought with his 10 propositions about the relationship between theology and sociology. Time does not permit me to comment on all 10 propositions, so I'll confine myself to two observations that I hope will contribute to conversation about improving the relationship between theology and sociology. First, I want to concur with John's main point that space explains the tortured relationship between sociology and theology, but that space also lies behind the re-enchantment of sociology. John spoke autobiographically about his experience of Queens in the 1980s and how Queens was then a space where the sociologists of secularization held sway and were perhaps not so open to engaging with religion or theology in a fruitful way. In contrast to John, I worked for the first 9 years of my career in an institution that was intentionally created to be a space where theology engaged with the social sciences, the Irish School of Ecumenics. ISE is situated in Trinity College Dublin, but I worked at the Belfast campus, which at that time was staffed by just two academics, myself, a sociologist of religion, and David Toombs, a theologian. There were additional theologians and social scientists at the Dublin campus of ISE. So ISE was not a hostile space to be a sociologist who took religion seriously. I may have had a unique experience in my life at ISE as a sociologist of religion. But in fact, within a couple of years, I was enlisted to design a sociological survey that would provide data about diversity, ecumenism, and reconciliation on the island of Ireland. That data was intended to establish an empirical base for theological reflection amongst ISE's theologians. So I duly collected that data and eventually wrote a sociological book based on it, the book that David mentioned, Transforming Post-Catholic Ireland. At a few workshops throughout the course of that project, ISE theologians reflected on the data, but there were no major publications where we managed to work together seriously as a sociologist and a theologians. This was disappointing to me, and as I thought about it over the years, I don't think it was because of any animosity to the findings or to a lack of goodwill about working together. Rather, and I think this adds to John's point about space, there was something lacking about the space that ISE occupied. It's one thing to create a space where theology and sociology are on friendly terms with each other, which I truly think we have and they still have at ISE. But it's quite another thing to convince the wider university to recognize and resource that space. ISE was, and I suspect still is, a rather marginal space within Trinity where resources and staff are scarce and the time needed for a substantial interdisciplinary engagement is just not available amidst the pressing demands and duties of teaching administration. Granted, this could be said for many spaces within the neoliberal university, I'm probably preaching to the choir here, but I think at ISE the problem was particularly acute. So this leads me to a general point that I think theologians and sociologists who value the insight of theologians must take on board. Whether we like it or not, theology as a discipline has been marginalized in the neoliberal university. This is at the same time as religion is gaining ground as a legitimate study of a legitimate subject of research and study in universities. So, for example, within the British Sociological Association, the Study of Religion study group is the second largest with more than 200 active members. So I would say the tide is turning against the disciples of secularization, who not only once held sway in the sociology of religion, but also across all levels of universities. Now, there is a growing recognition of the value of studying religion, but from social scientific rather than theological perspectives. At ISC, we saw this in the preference of the student body on the master's programs. Students wanted to learn about religion, but the theology modules were undersubscribed. So, as a sociologist of religion, my challenge to theologians is to communicate better about the value your work brings to conversations within the university and in the wider public sphere. So that leads me to my second observation. John's contribution pointed us towards some important issues of social life where theology could be expected to contribute significant insights. So I quote from his paper, empathy, love, hope, mercy, anger, forgiveness, suffering, compromise, peace, and the like. John also says that, and to quote, my complaint to theologians is that they do not wrestle enough with applied theology, avoiding putting their ideas into practice in hard situations. I agree with John's complaint, but I want to push further and highlight practical theology and public theology as promising avenues for engagement between theology and sociology. If you know where to look, Northern Ireland provides some significant examples of practical theology. Indeed, Northern Ireland has been a site for the development of sophisticated practical theologies of reconciliation, which do strive to reach out to public life. I'm thinking here of theologies done in community-based settings, such as recounted in the book by a former leader of the Corrymeela community, David Stevens, called The Land of Unlikeness, Explorations into Reconciliation, and a booklet by ISE's Johnston McMaster and Kathy Higgins called Doing Community Theology, Reflection on Education for Reconciliation. Academics working in universities have also contributed to the work of practical theology, including a recent useful book by Leah Robinson from Edinburgh on theologies of reconciliation developed by Corrymeela and the Cornerstone community. Embody Peace Building, Reconciliation as Practical Theology, a new edited volume. And within that, there's a chapter by David Toombs, now at the University of Otago, called Public Theology and Reconciliation. However, I think it is interesting that in his list of important issues in social life, John does not mention reconciliation. I'm aware that in his book, Religion, Civil Society, and Peace in Northern Ireland, John comments that reconciliation has not been a helpful term in Northern Ireland, in part because reconciliation means such different things to different people. John also argues that Christian discourses about relationships as a key to reconciliation have not aided the peace process because they have distracted Christian peacemakers from dismantling the social and political structures that fueled violence and continue to perpetuate division. Yet a close reading of David Stevens, Johnson McMaster, Kathy Higgins, Leah Robinson, David Toombs, and others reveals a concern for transforming both relationships and structures. I'm not saying that John somehow missed this dual focus on relationships and structures in these theologies of reconciliation. Rather, what I'm saying is that the translation from practical theology to public theology, if we think of public theology of what is actually heard in the public sphere, the emphasis on structures that arose out of practical community engagement was lost. So maybe it takes a sociologist to point this out, but it takes theologians to develop narratives to rectify a serious loss. Thanks.